Blackstone Audio presents Alvin Journeyman. By Orson Scott Card.
Chapter 1. I thought I was done. I thought I was done writing about Alvin Smith. People kept telling me I wasn't, but I knew why. It's because they'd all heard Tale Swapper and the way he tells stories. When he's done, it's all tied up neat in a package, and you pretty much know what things meant and why they happened. Not that he spells it all out, mind you, but you just have this feeling that it all makes sense. Well, I ain't Tale Swapper, which some of you might already have guessed, seeing how we don't look much alike, and I don't plan on becoming Tale Swapper anytime soon or anything much like him. Not because I don't reckon him to be a fine fella, worthy of folks emulating him, but mainly because I don't see things the way he sees them. Things don't all make sense to me. They just happen. And sometimes you can extract a bit of sense from some calamity, and sometimes the happiest day is just pure nonsense. There's no predicting it, and there's sure no making it happen. Worst messes I ever saw folks get into was when they was trying to make things go in a sensible way. So I set down what I knew of the earliest beginnings of Alvin's life right up till he made him the Golden Plow as his journeyman project. And I told how he went back to Vigor and set to teaching folks how to be makers and how things already wasn't right with his brother Calvin. And I thought I was done because anybody who cares was there from then on to see for themselves or, you know, somebody who was. I told you the truth of how Alvin came to kill a man so as to put to rest all the vicious rumors told about it. I told you how he came to break the runaway slave laws, and I told you how Peggy Larner's mama came to die. And believe me, that was pretty much the end of the story, as far as I could see it. But the ending didn't make sense of it, I reckon, and folks have been pestering me more and more about the early days, and didn't I know more I could tell? Well, sure I know. And I got nothing against telling it. But I hope you don't think that when I'm done telling all I know, it'll finally be clear to everybody what everything that's happened was all about, because I don't know myself. Truth is, the story ain't over yet. And I hope it never will be. So the most I can hope to do is set down the way it looks to this one fella at this exact moment. And I can't even promise you that tomorrow I won't come to understand it much better than anything I'm writing now. My knack ain't storytelling. Truth is, Tale Swapper's knack ain't storytelling either, and he'd be the first to tell you that. He collects stories, all right, and the ones he gathers are important, so you listen because the tale itself matters. But you know he don't do nothing much with his voice, and he don't roll his eyes and use them big gestures like the real orators use. His voice ain't strong enough to fill a good-sized cabin, let alone a tent. Nah, the telling ain't his knack. He's a painter, if anything. Or maybe a woodcarver or a printer or whatever he can use to tell or show the story, but he's no genius at any of them. Fact is, if you ask Tale Swapper what his knack is, he'll tell you he don't have none. He ain't lying. Nobody can ever lay that charge at Tale Swapper's door. No, he just set his heart on one knack when he was a boy. And all his life, that seemed to him the only knack worth having. And since he never got it, he thinks,
why then he must not have no knack at all. And don't pretend you don't know what knack it was he wanted, because he practically slaps you in the face with it whenever he talks for long. He wanted the knack of prophecy. That's why he's always been so powerful jealous of Peggy Larner, because she's a torch, and from childhood on, she saw all the possible futures of people's lives. And while that's not the same thing as knowing the future, the way things will actually happen instead of how they might happen, it's pretty close. Close enough that I think Tale Swapper would have been happy for 5 minutes of being a torch. Probably would have grinned himself to death within a week if such a thing happened. When Tale Swapper says he's got no knack, though, I'll tell you, he's wrong. Like a lot of folks, He has a knack and doesn't even know it because that's the way knacks work. It just feels as natural as can be to the person who's got it, as easy as breathing. So you don't think that could possibly be your unusual power, because heck, that's easy. You don't know it's a knack till other people around you get all astonished about it, or upset, or excited, or whatever feelings your knack seems to provoke in folks. Then you go.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.